The streets of Seattle aren't too safe. That's pretty common knowledge. Your chances of being victim to a crime on the streets of Seattle are 1 out of every 16 people. Crime is so commonplace there that when people commit even serious crimes out in the open, very little will be done to stop it as it's in progress, even if it's in a populated area. Now, I'm not just reading this off of a script. I say this as someone who has been to Seattle many times, and has witnessed numerous crimes take place against innocent people just minding their own business. Now, I'm not insinuating that because the people of Seattle aren't trying to fight crime that they're somehow immoral or selfish people. Let's be honest, no matter how heroic you may think you have the potential to be while staring at yourself in the bathroom mirror at 7 in the morning, if you walked by an alleyway where someone was being robbed, would you run over to them and start trying to wrestle the weapon out of the mugger's hand? Or would you just walk away and not get involved, for the safety of yourself or whoever you happen to be with at the time? Look, being a hero is never a smart thing to do in any situation, regardless of how much it says about your integrity and moral character. There's just too many complicated legal loopholes that'll get you in trouble even if you have the best of intent. Vigilante justice is also almost always dished out by people who perceive someone as being unlawful and take matters into their own hands, instead of police officers who can professionally analyze the situation and make a legal judgment themselves. Which, as you could imagine, can cause a lot of problems for everyone involved. Now, this video today is about a special someone who had the best of intentions, but failed to realize the reality of their own intent. I'd like you all to meet 30-year-old Benjamin John Francis Fodor, an MMA fighter from Seattle who became everything reality said he couldn't be, a real-life superhero. In his early 20s, Mr. Fodor was at Wild Waves with his young son. Which, if you aren't aware, Wild Waves is a large water park full of slides and other attractions. After Mr. Fodor and his son left from the park, they made their way over to their own vehicle. However, while doing so, Mr. Fodor's son tripped and fell right next to the vehicle. To their surprise, the vehicle's windows had all been busted out, and broken glass coated the concrete beneath it. Mr. Fodor's son was cut on various parts of his body and was bleeding profusely due to the glass he tripped and fell on. Mr. Fodor angrily looked around to see if anyone was nearby to assist him and his son in catching the person responsible for all of this. When doing so, he spotted an individual recording the whole situation on his phone from afar. When Mr. Fodor walked up to the individual and asked that they call the police for him and testify as a witness, the individual refused and stated that doing any of that would require that he turn off his recording for YouTube, which would ruin it. This was the beginning of Mr. Fodor's journey into becoming the first real-life superhero. Fodor was angered at the fact that there didn't seem to be any compassion or empathy on the streets of Seattle for those who had fallen victim to a heinous crime, something he'd come to learn more about shortly after this first incident at Wild Waves. A few weeks after this initial incident, Jones was outside of a bar that he frequented, sitting inside of his car, while waiting for a friend. While doing so, he noticed a crowd of about 70 people outside of said bar watching two individuals go at it violently. However, upon closer inspection, Mr. Fodor recognized one of the individuals involved in this. It was a friend of his, and he was actually being violently assaulted, clear as day. Not a single person in the crowd of 70 were doing a single thing about it, not even employees of the bar. And this is when Mr. Fodor decided to take action for once and for all. He called 911, reported the assault, and then he scavenged the items he had in his car to look for a disguise, so that the attacker wouldn't later recognize him or try to figure out who he was. Upon finding a ski mask in his glove box, he fashioned it to his face and quickly left his car before making a dash towards the attacker, making a loud commotion while doing so as to distract the attacker from what he was doing while the police made their way to the crime scene. The encounter was successful and the attacker was promptly arrested. This was the birth of something greater than Mr. Fodor himself. This was the dawn of Phoenix Jones. Shortly after this encounter, Mr. Fodor, adopting the alias Phoenix Jones, started sporting a utility outfit, fitted with bulletproof and stab-proof armor, along with pads to make his muscles look a lot bigger than they really were for intimidation purposes. He would then later stalk the streets of Seattle at night, looking for people causing trouble of any kind. Now, if you think that this idea, while a very noble one, is one that could get messy very quickly, You'd be right. On October 9th, 2011, Mr. Fodor was arrested for pepper spraying a belligerent woman in the eyes as a result of a dangerous altercation between the two. This event, considering who Mr. Fodor is, garnered significant media coverage for quite a while. As a result of Mr. Fodor's arrest, he unfortunately had to unmask himself publicly on television and admit to who he was. Which, if you're going to be a real-life masked superhero, something like that really puts a wrench in your plans.
The comic book vigilante, who has ended up on the wrong side of the law after being accused of assault, dramatically unmasked himself outside one of the city's courts on Thursday, revealing the man behind the mask, Benjamin Fodor.
I'm Phoenix Jones. I'm also Ben Fodor. I also protect the city. I also am a father. I also am a brother. I'm just like everyone else.
Although prosecutors say they have not yet decided whether to file charges, Mr. Fodor remained defiant.
What do you think? Should the DA, who is considering charging Phoenix with assault for the pepper spray, should he go ahead and do it?
Well, here's the problem. And listen, Phoenix, I love what you do. I think you're a courageous man, and we want to see you around for a long time. And it's for that reason that you have to stop doing it. I think the DA has a couple of problems here. Number one is that it's a deterrent effect. And what the prosecution wants to do, look, you don't have adequate equipment to do it. There's a training issue, and there's the fact that there's not legal authority to do it. Furthermore, whenever you inject yourself into an issue, there's always the problem that could get worse. And that is people can misconstrue intentions. It can escalate the situation. And it's for that reason that the DA has to take a stand. Now, I'm not saying
what
there should be life in prison without parole, but at the same time, there needs to be some type of assessment done by the DA so that other copycats don't come out here and we have a lawless society.
Joey obviously hasn't represented as many superheroes as I have, for starters. Number one, but our superhero said it best, crime is not okay. And when he takes to the streets dressed like that, it's no different than when a guardian angel puts on a red beret, and we all know what they're there for, to help stamp out crime.
Though this event did not stop Mr. Fodor from pursuing his dream of dishing out proper justice to those who needed it, this birthed the group vigilante movement known as the Rain City Superhero Movement. Now, if you thought one guy patrolling the streets of Seattle, dishing out justice with his fists of fury was a bad idea, how about adding a group of armed people dressed like ninjas to the equation? Alright, quick little shameless plug, but I make high quality music videos and songs on this channel, and I'd really appreciate if you checked them out. Links in the description. Thanks for watching this. Now, I'm not dissing the individuals involved with this movement. I've read quite a few reports on their heroic activities, and I can say they have done their fair share of good. A few of them have even stopped carjackings in progress. They've prevented intoxicated people from driving, they've stopped assaults, they've stopped vandals, and they even have apprehended a genuine sex offender. They also have done smaller but still noble things, such as advocate for the prevention of domestic abuse. I gotta say, that sex offender who was captured by these individuals might be the most unlucky individual of all time. Instead of just getting hunted by the police, he was hunted by both the police and the only group of real-life superheroes in the entire world. Anyway, Phoenix Jones, throughout all of this, proved to the world that he had immense moral integrity and that he was capable of being a great leader, along with also proving that he had a nice bod with washboard abs. However, all good things must come to an end, and so they did. The Rain City Superhero Movement was officially disbanded on May 29th, 2014 by the group's leader, Phoenix Jones. Why was it disbanded? Well, as you can imagine, having 20-something individuals walk the streets of Seattle with various weaponry taking justice into their own hands is a horrible idea in every single way, shape, and form. See, people who weren't even physically qualified at all were joining the movement in lieu of becoming a superhero just like Phoenix Jones. Not only were a lot of its members unqualified, some of them were also carrying illegal or lethal weaponry with them, which if used in any sort of fashion would most definitely result in the group being arrested for manslaughter, or worse. Needless to say, Phoenix Jones did not want these people tainting his good name. So, he ended it and continued on his own. However, as of 2019, he has officially retired. I can't say I don't absolutely respect the ground Phoenix Jones walks on. As a fan of movies like these, a dream of mine since childhood has always been to don a costume and punch wrongdoers in the face. Though honestly, if I was a real-life superhero, I would be deceased within 2 weeks, and I would most likely be found in a public bathroom located at a McDonald's. Not only did Mr. Fodor service his community in little and large ways by preventing scumbags from ruining it, but he also knew when to quit for the betterment of everyone around him. and that says more about him than any $500 uniform ever could. If you liked this video, please give it a thumbs up, subscribe, and hit the notification bell for more content. I know, I sound like Chills right now or some other spam channel, but trust me, I have quality to offer you. Real, intense quality. And again, don't forget to check out my music links in the description. That's all.